Congo, Congo nde mboka, mboka ngo mokengeli koi, mboka ngo mokengeli leopard. Mikolo to sekala kina mosolo ya mboka Congo ekoki tofungwani misolelo tomoni bozo banyoso tosali poya kobongisa Congo aveni ebongi tosala ebongi tosala
the Africa Center and the College of Arts and Sciences. I want to welcome you all for coming to this important lecture series and Palabra series. As you know, this is a series that attempts to foster dialogue and discussions on key issues of our time, African issues and global issues. We have an important guest today. And as we express our appreciation for his coming, and for this opportunity, we want to point out that this is a forum that encourages free discussions, all points of view, and opposing perspectives. We'll follow this up by way of, I want to take this opportunity also to invite you to come to Africa-China conference on the 24th of April and in March here. In fact, we have ambassadors here in one of the options we're posing is to have some African perspectives, so we have extended invitations to them. So without much ado, let me invite our colleague Dr. Mohamed Kamara to give his formal welcome. And again, welcome and thank you for coming.
Thank you, Dr. Halu. Good afternoon. As my esteemed colleague, Dr. Halu, just said, the Howard University Department of African Studies, in close collaboration with the Center for African Studies, prides themselves on being a top destination for teaching, learning, research on Africa, but also a place where we, the members of the community of Global Africa, meet, evaluate the opportunities that Africa brings to the world and the challenges that Africa faces, and we reflect on the solutions that Africans of Global Africa will bring to those challenges so as to meet them. And in that context, we have a number of African diplomats not only representing their respective countries, but also representing the continent to the United States, who have taken time from their busy schedules to be with us this afternoon. So it's my honor to introduce them. From the Embassy of the Republic of Cameroon, we have His Excellency Mr. Otundi Esomba, Ambassador Extraordinary and Plenipotentiary. From the Embassy of South Africa, Mr. Moreki, First Secretary Political. From the Embassy of the Democratic Republic of the Congo, Mr. Yves Bashonga, First Secretary. From the Embassy of Kenya, Mr. Adrizak Musa, Trade Officer. From the Embassy of the Kingdom of Morocco, Ms. Saba Bashir, Counselor in the Political Section. From the Embassy of the African Union, Ms. Seraphine Mani Ramboma, Policy Officer. And from the Embassy of the Republic of Cote d'Ivoire, Mr. Lucien Pouamon, Chief Communication Officer. So ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming our dear esteemed guests. I now invite Dr. Johnson to introduce our lecturer of the afternoon, Dr. Johnson.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming. Our esteemed lecture for this afternoon is being given by Dr. Noel Chiani. He is a senior economist who has held various positions, including World Bank country manager and mission leader for financial and private sector development. Dr. Chiani has had a long and illustrious career with the World Bank and was at the World Bank for the last 26 years and had previously been an international lending officer with Citibank as well as JP Morgan Chase in New York for 8 years. Dr. Chiani has completed the new manager's leadership program at the Graduate Business School at Harvard University and holds a doctorate in economics with a specialization in banking and finance from Université de Paris in France and a master's degree in business administration with a concentration in banking and financial markets from Adelphi University in New York. He also holds a master's degree in economics from the Université de Liège in Belgium. Dr. Chiani is also a prolific writer and author, scholar. He's authored 5 books, The Force of Change, Building a Better Country, Desperate Times, Call for Special Remedies, A Marshall Plan for the Congo, which is his most recent book that came out in April of 2016, on which much of his lecture will be based, Vision pour une monnaie forte, which was published in 2007, and Build Incredible Central Banks, and La bataille pour une monnaie nationale crédible. I hope I'm doing well with my French. Dr. Chiani is also a candidate in the upcoming DRC presidential elections, which will hopefully take place later on this year, and will certainly be a prominent political player in the post-Kabila scene in the Democratic Republic of Congo. The title of his lecture today is A Marshall Plan for the Democratic Republic of Congo, and we are excited to welcome you to Howard University and certainly look forward to you sharing your insights and perspectives with us. Thank you, Dr. Chiani.
Hello, everybody. I can hear you.
Hello.
Are you here today?
Yes.
Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Very good. Well, thank you. Thank you very much for that very kind introduction, Dr. Mr. Johnson. I would like to thank particularly Howard University Center for African Studies for sponsoring and hosting this conference today. My sincere appreciation to Dr. Cameron, to Dr. Hailu, and to Dr. Winston, and also to Kambi Kamara, who is standing there, a PhD student, for making this event possible this afternoon. Thank you so much for opening today the doors of this great university to me and to this great audience, to the African Union and the countries represented that Dr. Johnson mentioned earlier today. I would like to express my deepest appreciation for attending this event in solidarity with the people of the Democratic Republic of the Congo. I would like to acknowledge the presence of somebody who I don't see here yet. She has indicated to me that she will be coming probably very late, Catherine Marshall. Catherine Marshall is a former World Bank director who hired me at the World Bank, and she's the granddaughter of George Marshall, the US Treasury and Defense Secretary, under whom the United States of America launched and implemented the Marshall Plan for the reconstruction of Europe after World War II. And Catherine Marshall is very dear to me, and she's very excited She was very pleased to know that the plan for the reconstruction of the Congo is called the Marshall Plan, named after her grandfather. Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, as they said, my name is Noel Chiani Mwadiambita. I'm a son of the Democratic Republic of the Congo, and I'm here in that capacity. I'm not representing the World Bank in this event. I'm a banker, an international economist, and most recently, I am the author of a Marshall Plan for the reconstruction of the Republic, Democratic Republic of the Congo. I went to school mainly in Belgium, France, and here in the United States on the Congolese government scholarship. The government paid for all my tuition. I am grateful and owe my loyalty to the Democratic Republic of the Congo for having invested so heavily in me and brought me where I am today. Today, I will share with you the key element of my development vision for my country. I will first make a diagnosis of the situation of the DRC and identify key development challenges before presenting my strategy to accelerate economic and social development and create opportunities not for few individuals, but for all the Congolese people without exception. Let's begin by evaluating the state of the nation today, 57 years after independence from Belgium, and we got independence on June 30, 1960. The DRC is faring very poorly and going through a multidimensional crisis. I will mention political crisis, constitutional, security, economic, and social crisis. The political situation today is blocked by an unprecedented leadership crisis because the ruling majority has refused to organize a presidential and legislative election within the constitutional deadlines. Violations of the constitution are widespread, and they include the ban on public demonstration, the non-convening of the electorate 90 days before the end of the presidential term as required by the constitution, and the use of the excessive police force to repress freedom, resulting in loss of human lives. These violations are so flagrant that the Constitutional Court allowed itself to sit with 5 members out of 9, where its own rules of procedure require a minimum of 7 members out of 9 to sit validly. The decision of the Constitutional Court to allow the sitting president to remain in office into the inauguration of a new president elected beyond the constitutional deadline, that decision is unconstitutional. This manipulation of the constitution has created a climate of instability throughout the country. The DRC is in an unprecedented constitutional crisis. As of today, as we speak, the terms of the mandate of the President of the Republic, the senators and the people's representatives, their terms have all expired. Since December 19, 2016, the country is facing a recourse to Article 64 of the Constitution, which says that all Congolese citizens have the duty to defeat any individual or group of individuals who take power by force or who exercise power in violation of the provision of the Constitution of the country. The security situation is very bad. How many Congolese are massacred or killed every day without a word from the government, the army, the police, and the security services? Since 1996, the civil war has resulted in some 6 to 10 million deaths and literally destroyed the country's economic infrastructure and industrial base. Everything happens as if the state exists only by name and is there only to stifle individual freedoms. The DRC ranks very high on the list of human rights violations published every year by the Human Rights Watch, Amnesty International, and also by the US State Department. Gender-based violence is epidemic in my country. The economic and social situation of the DRC is catastrophic and is characterized by an alarming underdevelopment, extreme poverty, endemic corruption, and an appalling acceptance of poor governance as the norm. Despite its immense natural resources and human resources, the Democratic Republic of the Congo now has the lowest gross domestic product GDP per capita in the world and is ranked 228 out of 228 countries according to Index Mundi's ranking based on the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund statistics. Let me try to project on this. This is the ranking of all the countries of the world. You can see Qatar, which is an oil-producing country, being ranked the first one with $112,000 GDP per capita. And then we go down, you can see the United States of America is ranked the 15th, I think. 15th. It's in French. It does mean it's the United States of America. And as we go down, you will see that many countries, particularly the African countries, are at the bottom. But I'm going to go very quickly to the last one. You will see the one which is ranked 228 is the Democratic Republic of the Congo with a GDP per capita of, here it's $400, they round it up, but it's $394. The question is, how can a country with so many natural resources be ranked that way? In other words, the DRC is the poorest and least developed country in the world, with a system of governance so rotten that 85% of revenues from natural resources are not included in the national budget. Instead, they line the pocket of a corrupt elite, depriving the country of needed resources to finance development. Right now, today, more than 90% of the population live without access to safe drinking water, electricity, and telecommunication facilities. The country is unable to offer the population an education and health system as well as basic infrastructure worthy of the name. The solid economic growth on paper is neither inclusive nor concrete. People don't feel it, they don't touch it. Unemployment is close to 85% of the working population and is the main cause of poverty affecting 88% of our population. Because of poverty, life expectancy at birth in the DRC is only 50 years against, for example, 90 years in Monaco, a gap of 40 years. With the per capita GDP of $394 currently, the DRC, my country, is the poorest and least developed country in the world with 88% of the population living below the poverty line of $1.25 per day, despite its immense natural resources. In my country, very few individuals have amassed illegally billions of dollars for themselves, while the majority of the population has nothing and can't even afford food and medicine to survive. The Congolese franc, our national currency and a potent symbol of our sovereignty, is worthless, to the point that the dollarization, I mean the use of foreign currencies instead of local currency, dollarization accounts for 95% of the national economy, making any monetary policy meaningless. Ladies and gentlemen, based on this diagnosis, I am saddened to admit and recognize that my country has failed in terms of economic and social development and in terms of building strong and functioning institutions. The DRC is a failed state. And yet, I have high hopes. I have hope and I believe that the DRC can recover from a failed state to become a stable and prosperous country. But to do this, the DRC must meet several development challenges, which include providing the country with a competent, educated, honest, and visionary political leadership, restoring peace and security throughout the land, promoting public and private investment, and finally, promoting sustainable development, good governance, rule of law, strong democratic institutions, and inclusion of all our citizens. I hold the view that no country can emerge from underdevelopment and extreme poverty by accident, without a plan, without a vision. To bring the country out of the current catastrophic situation, as citizen of the DRC, I propose a coherent development strategy which would accelerate economic and social development, create opportunities for all Congolese, stabilize the country and the Great Lake region where there are always wars, and finally, jumpstart the overall development of Africa as a continent. This plan would lift my country out of extreme poverty to become a middle-income country in 15 years. My Marshall Plan for the reconstruction of the DRC is anchored in 10 pillars that I will share with you very briefly and which are detailed in my book, which is called La Force du Changement, or The Force of Change, and the book is available there for those who wish to have a copy. And there is even a small summary of this book, which is about 100 pages for those who don't want to read 500 pages. Let's begin with the first pillar of the strategy. Promote peace, security, the rule of law, and democracy. We must create the condition for national unity and cohesion. We must work at the level of the people and the different components of political and civic society and make it a top priority. This is the key to success. The major challenges are all in need of a collective commitment, and it is not impossible to achieve it, despite the differences between them. We must re-engage in the DRC, the democratic process, and go to the polls as soon as possible so that we can have legitimate elected leaders. Democracy cannot be decreed. It must be practiced. I know it's a long and hard process, but this is essential. It is the sine qua non condition of a productive and peaceful society. To pacify the country as a whole and protect all Congolese citizens, it will be necessary to restore the authority of the state throughout the country and reform the army, police, security services, because the current insecurity does not promote a sustainable economic and social development. It will be necessary to reform the state and public administration in order to establish strong and functional democratic institutions. Without institutions, a country is doomed to fail. Individuals go and pass, but institutions will stay. We must promote institutions instead of relying on one or two individuals. To improve the political environment, it will require us to reduce the number of political parties from 700 today to no more than 2 or 3 so that democracy can function normally. And finally, it will be fundamental to reform the justice system for greater independence, functionality, and fairness so that we don't have people, when they want to run for president, you just hear that there has been a decision of the court preventing that person from running. No, it should not be that way. This takes me to the second pillar of the strategy. Promote good governance and efficient use of public resources. The DRC is now recognized by Transparency International and other civic institutions as a typical example of a country's poor economic and political governance. No development, in my view, is possible with the present system of governance. But how can we improve the governance of the country to promote development and eliminate poverty? I take the view that good governance begins by placing the right men in the right place, including at the level of the head of state, and by holding him accountable for his action. We must break with rotten governance and impunity. I believe that inclusive growth and shared prosperity can only be achieved on the solid foundation of governance and institution administered by what I call a capable state. To improve governance and public service delivery, we will support democratic and civic society institutions such as the National Electoral Committee, which is called the Congo CENI, so that they can organize the election regularly on time. We'll support the parliamentarian or member of Congress. We'll support the media organization. We will facilitate the spread of the democratic culture by developing and teaching the guide for democratic principle. We will support the financial decentralization of the country to give more power and autonomy to local government and to local communities. We will reinforce the transparency in the procurement of goods and services, and we will support this capacity building of the local administration, and at the same time promote internal revenue generation to reduce dependency on foreign aid and foreign assistance to support a sustainable development. We will fight corruption, tribalism, favoritism, and conflict of interest by prohibiting the accumulation of function for the government official. You find today a minister, he's a minister, he's a cabinet member, but at the same time he has a private law office. He takes the information from his job and then he sends to his private law office. That's a conflict of interest. It cannot function that way. To raise internally generated revenues, we will eradicate corruption in the government and in the society by appropriate measures. These measures will include, among other things, the strict implementation of labor laws, enforcement of minimum wage across the sectors. We will establish what I call the National Bureau for the Promotion of Good Governance and for Fighting Corruption that will be equipped with a hotline for whistleblowers to report suspected corruption cases. And whistleblowers will be protected by the law and will be compensated with a percentage ranging from 1 to 5% of proceeds from corruption recoveries. We will organize the audit of civil servant list across the sector and throughout the country to eliminate what we call phantom cases. You find the list of civil servants, it's very long. But in reality, those who are in charge of supervising this process, they have phantom cases, people who don't exist. And every month they take money for themselves. We are going to audit and pay the person when we see that he does exist. Saving which will be generated will be put in the national budget to finance development projects. And the anti-corruption drive will be the key component of this Marshall Plan to raise internally generated revenues and reduce dependency on foreign aid. This is, by the way, the major difference between this plan for the Congo and the Marshall Plan for Europe after World War, which was basically financed with grant and loans from international community. This takes me to the third pillar of the strategy. Promote investment in human capital to support sustainable development. We will here implement a comprehensive agenda to rehabilitate three sectors affecting the quality and durability of the human capital as key ingredient of a sustainable development in the DRC. These three sectors are education, health, and food security. Rehabilitation program for primary, secondary, university, and vocational education will include the updating of curricula. I was shocked to see that I went to see one university, I found the kids doing their work for the end of the bachelor program, and this guy was still doing research on Karl Marx and the Marxist system. And I just told them, well, it's good to know, but things have changed quite a bit out there. Karl Marx doesn't exist and these theories are completely out of date. We need to update the curricula that our schools are using to teach the kid. The program is going to include the construction of new infrastructure, the rehabilitation of existing infrastructure, as well as the recruitment and training of new teachers up to international standard. The DRC should make education compulsory and free for children aged 6 to 17 years to promote social inclusion. Here, this is a point where I'm very sensitive. I am the product of free education. I feel that if I did not have the possibility to benefit from assistance from my government, I would not be presenting to you today the Marshall Plan for the reconstruction of the Congo. So if they've done it for me, I would like to do it for other kids, so that they can have the chance in their life. We will introduce the social inclusion and human capital development policy, which will include, in addition to this free compulsory education, also the national scholarship program for the most deprived families, the computerization of schools, the adequate remuneration and continuing training of the teaching staff, the use of the internet from primary education, and the construction of modern libraries will be the key element in the reform of the education system that I am proposing. Here you cannot see it. You should go to Kinshasa and see what we call universities. Libraries, no books. How can the kids learn? Our goal will be to transform the DRC into a pool of intelligence and know-how in key areas related particularly to our natural resources. The professionalization of teaching should lead to a good knowledge of our soil, our subsoil, our minerals, forests, and all our natural resources. It is inconceivable today that there should be no school specializing, for example, in diamond in the Kasai province where diamond is produced, or school specializing in wood or water courses in Bakongo, Bandundu, Oriental Province, or the Kivus. It is unacceptable that the DRC has no university in the top 100 African universities. No university. And if we don't have an education system up to date, we are shooting ourselves in the foot. In the health sector, we will have to build a modern hospital, recruit and train doctors and nurses in sufficient numbers, and introduce a universal health insurance system that some of the colleagues are now calling Chani Care, to enable all our citizens to have access to health care in the country. In addition to universal health insurance, our social inclusion and human capital development policy will include the Equal Opportunities Card, which will provide free medical services for people with disabilities, for children aged 0 to 5 years, and also for persons over 60 years of age without income. This health care system, or Chani Care, will allow our people to live with dignity and achieve their God-given potential. The improvement of life expectancy at birth. Remember, I told you that it was 50 years in the DRC against 9 years in Monaco. That improvement depends on this healthcare system and will be a top priority in our health policy. The promotion of good security is also another element affecting the quality of human resources. It will be achieved through the development and mechanization of agriculture, livestock, and fisheries. As such, we will develop a system of financing agro-pastoral activities and build infrastructure in rural areas, including roads, electricity, and water, to attract investment in agriculture, livestock, and fisheries, so as to develop a complete food industry in the country. We will also set up a mechanism for buying agro-pastoral product and for selling this product to domestic and foreign market in order to promote economic development and ensure adequate purchasing power for producers, peasants, fishermen, and breeders. This is how we will create millions of jobs and reduce poverty in rural areas where 60% of our population lives. This takes me to the fourth pillar of our strategy. Promote the emergence of national finance. This will involve reforming the central bank as monetary authority, the national currency, and the financial system. The DRC needs to reorganize its national finance to make it much more competitive and diversified to address the need of its people, the need of its economy. Currently, the DRC has no banks, for example, in the top 150 banks, according to French-based magazine called the Jeune Afrique. We have no bank in the top 100 African banks. We need to evolve from the current financial system, where all banks belong either to foreigners or to political families. We will promote the emergence of a national financial system where nationals have a role to play, not only as employees, but also as shareholders and managers of financial institutions. When a country does not control its financial system, it is my view that it is not controlling its economy and can't use its financial system as an efficient wealth redistribution mechanism. The GRC needs a modern financial system that includes, just like here, commercial banks, investment banks, insurance companies, leasing and factoring companies, capital market, mortgage companies, development bank, quality financial intermediaries, a deposit insurance institution, and the stock market. Here, I want to make to underline something. Over the last 20 years, there have been maybe 20 banks that went bankrupt in the DRC. And guess what? Every time that the bank goes bankrupt, all the depositors, they lose their money. Everybody. And there is no recourse. You cannot go to complain. Who are you going to complain to? There is no recourse. And I am shocked that we have not, as a country, seen that problem and tried to solve it by creating a deposit insurance company, such as FDIC here, or other mechanism whereby people can feel comfortable and develop confidence in the financial sector. We will restructure the central bank for greater independence, accountability, and competence. And once the macroeconomic environment will be stable enough, we will restructure the national currency to end the dollarization of the economy. I mentioned before, the dollarization is the use of foreign currencies against the local currency. We will end the dollarization of the economy, which is causing the loss of senior revenues and does not allow for a credible, independent monetary policy undertaken by the central bank. This takes me to the fifth pillar of our strategy. Promote the emergence of a responsible national private sector. I hold the view that an attractive business environment is essential to encourage job creation in the private sector, as well as the structural and radical transformation of the economy from an outward-oriented economy to a balanced economy serving the needs of the domestic and international market. The GRC is ranked today 184th out of 189 countries in 2016 and ranks among the worst African countries as investment destination according to World Bank Doing Business indicators. Why such a bad rating? Well, because of administrative procedures, taxation, bureaucracy, fiscal harassment, and political instability. But also because of difficulties in connection with electricity grid, energy supply, water supply, and the quality of human capital. To address this private sector bottleneck, we will implement a comprehensive reform agenda that includes, among other things, the reform of the justice system, a simplification of the tax laws and bureaucratic procedures, and a serious fight, I mean very serious fight, against corruption. And you cannot fight corruption if you are corrupt yourself. Me, I can tell you, I have never been corrupt. So if I say that I'm going to fight corruption, I am serious. These measures will be complemented by a comprehensive reform of the public enterprise and incentive to be given to the Congolese diaspora wishing to invest in their home country. And those incentives to the diaspora will include, among other things, custom exemption on import of productive machinery and also assistance for reinstallation back in the Congo. This takes me to the sixth pillar of our strategy. Implement a major infrastructure development program. We will implement a multi-year program to build labor-intensive infrastructure, including roads. All those lines that you see in red are the road and highway which don't exist, but that we plan to build. including road, highway, bridges, railroad. Railroad, those are the black land there. They don't exist today. We are planning to build them in this master plan. And we'll build hospital, public schools, public market, national park, water and electricity, as well as the development of the river and river for inland water, waterway transport. Everything has to be done. The Congo is today at the stage where, I don't know, the United States was maybe 200-300 years ago. So we know the technology does exist. Why can't we do it? So if we want to do it, the people of the Congo, we are going to do it according to our own plan. This is our vision of development, and I'm calling on the international community to assist us to implement our own vision instead of imposing on us some plan designed somewhere else which don't reflect the reality of our country. A priority will be to make drinking water and electricity accessible to all the Congolese, and to connect all the corners of the country by road and railway, while public transport in major cities such as Kinshasa, Lubumbashi, Kisangani, Mbujimayi, Kananga will be provided by metro and buses. It is feasible and we can do it. The construction of the iconic 80 billion Grand Inga Dam will be a national priority, not only to provide electricity to all the 80 million Congolese, but also to provide, to promote the accelerated industrialization of the country. And in addition to that, the construction of this Inga Dam will be a source of hard currency, as the electricity will be sold to other African countries and even outside of Africa. Along the road and highways throughout the country, we will develop what I call modern cities. This will create demand for products and services to support economic growth and development over 15 years and even beyond. The infrastructure development plan will be implemented following a comprehensive 15-year master plan that we have here, and will be a major source of job for local communities and local people. This takes me to the seventh pillar of our strategy: promote and accelerate the country's industrialization. This pillar will enable local processing of our minerals and natural resources. It requires mechanization of agriculture, stock breeding and fishing, orderly exploitation of our forest, and development of tourism. My country, the Democratic Republic of the Congo, as you know, has immense natural resources. Its area is equivalent to 2/3 of the European Union and about 1/3 of the United States. So we are a big country. The DRC is the second largest African country after only who? Algeria. It is the largest country in sub-Saharan Africa in terms of land area. It is the most populous country on the African continent after only who? Nigeria, Egypt, and Ethiopia. The geographical location put the DRC in the heart of Africa and at equal distance to South Africa to the south and Algeria to the north. We are in the center, the heart of Africa. The DRC is the only country in Africa to share borders with 9 different countries. The DRC and its neighbor, they have a combined population of 280 million people, almost like the size of the American population. 280 million people. Some of the DRC natural resources include a repertoire of 1,100 precious metals worth some $24 trillion. 125 million hectares of arable land, good for agriculture. 135 million hectares of forest. 100,000 megawatts of hydroelectric potential. 53% reserve of African water, 15% reserve of world water, and a sizable amount of oil and renewable energy such as solar, nuclear, biomass, methane gas, and coal. The country has today a population of 80 million people that is projected to reach 190 million by year 2050, 60% of whom is below the age of 20. But a fundamental question for us is the following: how can we ensure
the natural resources of the country are used to develop the country for the benefit of its people. To address this important question, I am proposing an industrialization policy that will consist of transforming locally some of the natural resources to produce semi-finished and finished goods so as to add value to the national economy and create jobs for the people of the Congo. By selecting, for example, 100 mineral and precious metals out of the 1,100 that I just mentioned in the repertoire, and by transforming them locally into semi-finished and finished goods, on the condition that each item selected adds 5 to 10 direct and indirect new jobs to the local economy, we shall produce between 50 and 100 million jobs over 15 period. This would allow us to reach what? Full employment, and put the country in a position to import skilled labor from where? From other African countries, Asia, Europe, and North America. This strategy will therefore benefit not only the Congolese people, the Congolese citizen, but also the Great Lake region, the rest of Africa, and the rest of the world. For an effective implementation of this policy, we will establish the National Agency to Promote Industrialization. This agency will sponsor technological research for the transformation of raw materials and precious metal. It will sponsor the feasibility study for the transformation of local precious metal, commodities, and natural resources. And it will negotiate relocation agreement to attract foreign companies into the Democratic Republic of the Congo. The DRC will then aim to become, like China and the United States of America, a major production center of selected semi-finished and finished product. Are you following me?
Yes.
This takes me to the eighth pillar of the strategy. Promote the national and regional integration as well as international cooperation. National integration is the creation of an internal market by integrating the 26 provinces of the country through the development of integrating roads and highways. This national integration would create an internal market of how many people? 80 million people, because that's the population of the Congo. But in addition to national integration, we will promote regional integration to link the DRC with other African countries. And the DRC and the 9 neighboring countries, as I said before, have a combined population of 280 million people. That's a big market. We have to seize that. In addition, the DRC forms with a group of 26 other African countries, ranging from South Africa in the south to Egypt in the north, a tripartite trade zone, including the common market of Eastern and Southern Africa, commonly known as COMESA, the East African Community, known as EAC, and the Southern African Development Community, or SADC, with a combined population of 625 million people and a gross domestic product of $1.2 trillion. We will take advantage of the potential offered by this regional integration to diversify the national economy by capitalizing on the benefit of an already large internal market of 80 million people. But these sizable local and regional markets are the main justification supporting my vision of a well-articulated industrialization policy to meet the local and regional demand of quality product and services. This takes me to the ninth pillar of the strategy. Mobilize human resources to implement this Marshall Plan. Where will we get the human capital that we need to implement such a massive plan over 15 years? Because the main beneficiaries of this Marshall Plan are the Congolese people, we will mobilize Congolese from within and from the diaspora to implement this vision of development with a strong national ownership. We will use international expertise if and when that is necessary. The DRC currently suffers what I call brain drain. As talented, educated, motivated citizens leave the country to go and emigrate overseas. It also suffers brain waste, with few opportunities for those who stay behind to work, to study, to better themselves, or to achieve their full potential in the Congo. At the individual and the national level, this situation is nothing short of tragic. We must and we will reverse this trend. The Congolese diaspora will play an important role in the development of the country because it stays abroad, allowed to be in contact with different ways of doing things at all levels of the country. The diaspora is an inescapable force of nearly 8 million people out of the 80 million population of the DRC. Remittances, for example, from the diaspora to their families in the Congo are estimated at some $14 billion a year in 2016, more than three times the DRC's national budget of $4.5 billion in 2017, and more than five times the official development assistance. Several studies have shown that over 80% of foreign trained migrants return to their home country of origin and become real development players if the country is stable and promote the return in a sustained manner. This is why we have to stabilize the country so that we can stop this brain drain and then attract back the people to the country. Instead of building a wall between the DRC and America or the rest of the world to stop the massive exodus or immigration of people, it is best, in my view, to support the country's development to create opportunities that will attract back these citizens to their homeland. This takes me to the last pillar, the 10th pillar of the strategy. Mobilize financial resources to implement this Marshall Plan. Where will we get the money, the financial resources, to implement this plan? Yeah. Our priority will be to raise domestic financial resources so that the country is less dependent on external aid. Currently, almost 45 to 60% of the budgetary resources come from foreign assistance. This situation is just not sustainable from the development point of view. You cannot develop yourself by depending on presents that some international community or some foreign countries are going to give you. We must fight corruption to recover the 85% of income from natural resources that do not go into the coffers of the state today. And we will also attempt to recover and will recover the 10 to 15 billion that the DRC loses every year in the form of tax fraud and embezzlement of public funds. This is known by everybody. By recouping these lost revenues, the annual budget of the DRC would amount to an estimated $20 billion from the first to the fourth year of the plan, and an average of $72 billion from the fifth to the 15th year of the plan. It will also involve raising external financial resources from bilateral and multilateral donors, and also from the private sector in the form of foreign direct investment. The total cost to implement this Marshall Plan is therefore $800 billion over 15 years. Contribution from bilateral and multilateral donors are projected at $45 billion over 15 years, or about $3 billion a year. And contribution from the private sector are projected at $75 billion over 15 years, or $5 billion a year on average. This external contribution would reduce the cost of the government in the total, the share of the government in the total financing cost from $800 billion to $680 billion over 15 years, or the government will have to have a budget of $45.3 billion per year on average over a year, period of 15 years. This estimate of the DRC annual budget of $45.3 billion per year over the 15-year period to successfully implement this Marshall Plan is feasible, doable, possible, realistic, and achievable as it compares favorably to the Angolan government annual budget of $66 billion, for example, 2015, and South African budget of $125 billion in 2017. In conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, we can all imagine a better world that we wish to bequeath to our children and grandchildren. How can we not? The reconstruction of the DRC will be the work not of a handful of people, but of all its 80 million inhabitants who constitute its main raw material for development, complemented, of course, by a vibrant diaspora, a responsible national private sector, and an international community, including multilateral and bilateral partners, as well as direct foreign investors. Implementing this vision of development will achieve full employment and raise per capita GDP from $394 today to at least $15,000 in 15 years. We have collectively the power and the means to make this vision a reality. But to achieve this level of unprecedented development, the DRC needs a fundamental change that cannot come by itself. The change cannot be accomplished by simply replacing President Joseph Kabila with one of his current or former lieutenant who must be held accountable for the country's disappointing performance to date. A real change should come from leaders with a new vision of development of the country. And by new leaders, I mean people who are educated, honest, known for unpeachable integrity and untainted by the poor governance of the past. I mean men and women wholly loyal to the Democratic Republic of the Congo and its people. Having studied in Europe and the United States on the Congolese government scholarship, I know for sure that my country has given me everything to make me what I am today. Now is my turn to give back. The Democratic Republic of the Congo needs new leaders with new ideas for a fresh start, and not those who are pushed upon us by lobbyists and influence peddlers heavily paid with stolen money from my country. Proverbial wisdom, repeated only in irony, says that what's impossible isn't Congolese. Bitter experience has taught too many of my compatriots quite the opposite. But we know from recent experience that great progress is possible, even in the poorest, most fragile corners of the world. Progress that conveys prosperity and security, not only for individual economies, but in this era of fast-moving global threat, for us all. Refining and implementing this new Marshall Plan for the Democratic Republic of the Congo is where the country's transformational work should begin, to create conditions for a sustainable development beyond the usual cosmetic reforms. This plan will be a big step toward stabilizing and promoting development of one of the most important countries in the Great Lakes region and in Africa. Congo is not any kind of country. This is a big country. It's a subcontinent. With the implementation of this Marshall Plan, we shall create, in the heart of Africa, a new Democratic Republic of the Congo, a more stable, more prosperous, more equitable, more beautiful, and much stronger country than ever before. I dream of the Democratic Republic of the Congo that can be and that will be that way, and I invite you to join me in making it a reality. If God smiled my country by blessing it with so many natural resources, He is also challenging us to prove our worth by leveraging them wisely and justly for the benefit of all, leaving no one behind. Just as President Donald Trump and some in this country focus on making America great again, me and my compatriots shall devote our time and energy on making the Democratic Republic of the Congo simply great. Each of us will then be rightly and justly a patriot in his own country. May God bless the Democratic Republic of the Congo and Africa, and God may bless you all. Thank you.
Mosolo ya mboka Congo ekoki tofungwani misolelo tomoni bozo banyoso tosali boya kobongisa Congo aveni ebongi tosala ebongi tosala moto nyoso.